This is Let Your Voice Be Heard, right here on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
Old Westbury Selena would dance to this, but she wouldn't dance with nobody because she was too cool. That didn't even rhyme a little bit. We are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM,
tried.
WHCR, the voice of Harlem. Guys, do you know what this is? This is our last show of 2019, of the decade.
Whoa.
Wow.
What a decade it's been. In this decade, Selena almost got me fired as an RA, and we put Let Your Voice Be Heard on hiatus and then brought it back. And when we brought it back with wonderful people like Ilyssa Fuchs.
What up?
Mike Graciopo, Dustin Pulsar, Patricia Valoy. Who am I forgetting, Selena?
About 8 more people.
Yo, we had so many
Jason.
People. Jason Alejo. Yo.
Jackie
Cohen.
Mike.
I said Mike,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, you did say Mike. Okay.
Carlisle.
Yeah.
Was it Jasmine?
Jessica.
Jessica. Yo, we had a huge cast.
We really did. It kind of felt like seasons of Love and Hip Hop, because we just kept shifting the cast every season.
Next season we got Joe Budden.
Right, no, seriously. But no, it's literally been 10 years of Let Your Voice Be Heard and of the decade, and I'm super happy to close out the show with you guys. And, you know, people like Evan, who is one of our newest correspondents, and one of the best.
Oh, thank you.
No, of course, of course.
Where do I rank in your host, Lena?
Very low.
Okay, that's fair. I accept that.
Yes. Yeah, so anyway, guys, so welcome to Let Your Voice Be Heard, where we talk politics, social issues, and pop culture. And we do that all from our very diverse perspectives. My name is Selena Hill on Instagram and Twitter. You can follow me at Miss Selena Hill. And I'm happy to have Ilyssa Fuchs back. At one point, she was a permanent co-host on Let Your Voice Be Heard.
And, good morning.
Okay, and now she is back as a correspondent.
Yes, I am. Although, you know, putting the word correspondent doesn't fit on my Twitter bio, so I just left it as co-host.
Did you?
I don't have enough characters for the word correspondent. It's too long.
Gotcha. See, that's why I don't like Twitter. They don't respect you like that.
They don't. They really don't.
You know what's trending on Twitter right now?
What?
The baby's meat.
What's that mean?
The rapper the baby.
Yes. So the baby's nudes have leaked. Stanley, did you see
know
them?
What I...
No.
I thought
on purpose, I did not see them.
You know what I thought of, right?
He's 5'6". And his meat is 6'10", apparently.
That's what they've been saying. So right, they say.
That was too much for me to ever know.
That's what Donald Trump says, too, but you know.
Right, he does make the same claim.
I was thinking of the thing Cuba Gooding Jr. said in the club when you said that.
What did he say?
You don't remember? I can't repeat the whole thing now.
Well,
but
pause that for Let's Not Be Trash.
All right.
Well, speaking of Let's Not Be Trash, Evan, did you want to introduce yourself?
Yes,
and your podcast?
I am the co-host and co-founder of Let's Not Be Trash with my boy Stanley. And yeah, you could find us at letsnotbetrash.com, letsnotbetrash with just B, not B-E, on Instagram. And you can find me at _Mastronardi. And yeah, I'm always excited to get the call on Let Your Voice Be Heard.
Yes. So, and Stanley, last and certainly not least, did you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, what's going on? You guys know who this is. This is Stanley Fritz, your favorite PC on the engineers. I get it wrong all the time now. Your favorite engineer on the PC ones and twos. You can find me on Twitter at Stan Fritz. You can find me on IG at Stan Fritz. You can find me on Snapchat at Darkskin Swindle. Just kidding. I actually don't know what my name is on Snapchat anymore, but you can find me in all those places, and I'm always happy to talk to you, unless I'm not. Also, currently considering deleting my Facebook. So that's where we are today.
Wow. Well, speaking of Facebook, so we have a great show lined up. We're going to be talking about the last decade, everything in our political lives and things that have been going on socially, but also our personal lives. And that's why Stanley brought up some of the memories and nostalgia of Let Your Voice Be Heard, because we've been going strong for 10 years. If you don't, well, we had like a 1-year hiatus, so we technically we relaunched in 2011. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, still, we've been here for the most part of the decade. And, you know, we want to just thank you guys for sticking with us and supporting us for all of these years and the topics and the causes that we talk about. And, why not throw it back and reminisce a little bit? You know what? We need to play that song, Reminisce on the Time.
Oh, what? Who sings that song?
I don't know, Stanley.
It's an old one. How am I supposed to find it?
You know, y'all know the song, Reminisce.
No one knows the song, Selena.
Everyone knows that song.
Hello?
It's from like
everyone?
92.
Everyone, do you know the song? Do you remember the song?
Call us if you know the song.
I was just about to say.
212-650-6903.
We'll be waiting.
Do you remember the time?
No, I wasn't talking about,
Or a time to remember.
You know what? On this commercial break, I'm going to find the song. And then we're probably going to play it. And also, we're going to be talking about the impeachment too, guys. So, yeah, we're ending 2019 with the president probably not going to get impeached. But we're going to talk about it.
Until then, let's enjoy the Black National Anthem for SUNY Old Westbury. Oh, yeah, yeah, I want that booze. Yo, when this song came out, by the way, yeah. This is Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM WHCR, the voice of Harlem. One of my best friends, Claude LaRoche, said this song is about the Illuminati, and she's sacrificing herself in the video. And I was like, you're an idiot. And then he sent me to a website, which broke the whole thing down, and I was like, you're an idiot. Then the next day, he tried to take me to the website, and the website was down. And he was like, see? They're trying to stop them from telling the truth.
Well, can I just say, back in 2010, I also believed in the Illuminati conspiracies.
Does you mean still do?
No, I don't. I no longer believe in that, Stanley. But anyway, so we're back. This is Let Your Voice Be Heard right here on WHCR 90.3 FM. Shout out to everyone who's listening via podcasts on SoundCloud, Spotify, iTunes, and everywhere else that they get their podcasts. So we're kicking off the show. Before we go back into the 10-year challenge and talk about some of the nostalgia of the last 10 years, we need to talk about this impeachment. So apparently, on last Wednesday, a few days ago, the House voted to impeach President Trump. Now it is up to Nancy Pelosi. She said that she's still deliberating on if and when she's going to send the two articles of impeachment to the Senate. She wants to make sure that she has full support and that President Trump will have a fair trial and, you know, and move forward with the impeachment. So, you know, my question to you guys is, you know, Alyssa, were you expecting this to happen? Were you rejoicing when it happened? And what does this really mean?
I mean, look, I'm not rejoicing because, number one, it's a sad thing when a president gets impeached. You know, I know people are happy about it because they don't like Donald Trump. But ultimately, what it means is that we're having a terrible constitutional issue in our country where the president is being accused of serious, serious crimes and misconduct. But the other reason why I'm not rejoicing is because nothing's going to happen. Because at the end of the day, impeachment is a political process. It's not really, it's a legal process, but it's really a political process. And the impeachment only means he's been charged, quote unquote, with these crimes. And it's going to go over the Senate. And as you heard from Mitch McConnell last week, he's not an impartial juror. He's coordinating with the White House. He's coming to the president's defense, which is essentially to say that he's not going to act as an impartial juror. He's going to defend the president. And ultimately, they don't have the votes to remove the president, or at least they don't think they do. And so this whole thing is really going to end in a big, fat nothing burger.
Well, good point, Alyssa. But I think one thing may actually happen. Evan, it looks like this impeachment is rallying Trump's base. In fact, since the impeachment proceedings began, the Republican National Committee has seen over 600,000 new donors, and the campaign and the RNC raised $10 million in small donations in just 48 hours during the impeachment week. Of course it's not, but it's no. Alyssa says nothing's going to happen. I say something is happening on the Republican base. What do you think about that?
Well, you mean nothing's going to happen, that it's not going to be removed, right?
Right.
Yeah. So there's two elements here. There's like the constitutional element, then there's the political element.
Exactly.
So constitutionally, I mean, if you're not going to impeach someone for this, then when? So I definitely think it is the duty, based on his actions, to impeach him. Now, politically, it's not going to help anybody. The best thing that can happen is that this process is wrapped up with enough time before the election. Because what may happen, remember Mitch McConnell stalled Merrick Garland for an entire year, and we never got that Supreme Court justice. I will not be surprised if he stalls this, too, with Nancy Pelosi, up until it's like right up until the election. So then when he likely will get exonerated by the Senate, it will even motivate his base more and give him more momentum. So the closer this is to the election, the worse it is politically for Donald Trump. For us, the better for Donald Trump.
So do you think, Stanley, that Nancy Pelosi waited too long because we are, you know, inching towards we're literally almost in 2020. We're getting closer to the election, and it seems like it's only rallying his base. Should we have impeached him back when the Robert Mueller report came out?
No, it doesn't matter. This is probably the most viable time they've had to put legitimate impeachment proceedings. This is the first time period where you had over 50% of the U.S. population that being polled saying that he should be impeached. And you still have that. There was no perfect time. Republicans were never going to do the right thing. This is not about that. But I do have a question for Alyssa about this that I heard, that since once a president has been impeached, they cannot be pardoned for anything. Is that true? Because if that's the case, then, like, I don't care if Republicans don't let this go through. if Trump can't be pardoned anymore and he can really get in trouble when he leaves the White House, I'm for it.
I mean, Trump could always be pardoned by another president.
Yeah.
So
even if he's impeached?
Even if he's impeached.
By a president, yes.
Right. So if Trump gets impeached and then he gets removed and then he's charged by the Department of Justice, and this is all big ifs, right? And then he's charged by the Department of Justice with actual crimes, or even if, you know, then he could be pardoned by a president, the next president who has the pardon power. Now, there's one caveat to that, which is if he is charged with crimes under state law. So, for example, if Cy Vance in Manhattan charges him with crimes, then theoretically the only person who could pardon him if he was convicted of those crimes would be the governor, which is right now Andrew Cuomo, although there's some question as to whether or not he actually could be charged in New York because of the way New York's double jeopardy law is written. You might have just heard last week the charges were dropped against Paul Manafort in New York because one of the courts, the high court in New York, ruled that those charges cannot be brought under the currently existing double jeopardy law that exists. So
they're going to change those laws this session, so that might not help Trump much longer.
So, Stanley, you know, as we wrap this up, next steps, what do you see happening moving forward?
I think the next steps are, like, we know what the Republicans are going to do. I think it's really important to just be educating folks in the way that's, like, digestible and real so that they understand what's happening or why Trump is such a problem. I saw a really good tweet that we shared on our IG page. Thanks, Mariah. You lit for that. Where they were explaining why the impeachment process was so bad. And it was like, imagine you caught your boyfriend cheating. And in order to break up with him, you had to convince his five best friends, the guys who were cheating with him, to like allow you to break up. That's what we're facing right now with the Republican Party and the Senate. So folks need to understand what's going on. Those are really good ways you can learn about the process. And if you guys have any questions, concerns, or curse words, give us a call at 212-650-6903.
Well, you know, speaking of, you know, things that were maybe shocking to some, or
the baby's meat.
Well, I actually wasn't going to go back to the bait, but since you keep harping on the baby's leaked nudes, I mean, Steph Curry's nudes also leaked a few days ago, and people were actively seeking those out. But I heard
Are you people, Selena?
I know. I heard Ayesha Curry was mad that her nudes didn't leak, and everyone was paying attention to Steph.
Wait, what? Speaking of the 10-year challenge, I know we're not there yet, but wasn't it about, I don't know, 5-6 years ago when Jennifer Lawrence and all those other nudes leaked?
You know? Oh, yeah.
That was awful. That was
fapping,
awful.
I remember
that was the fapping.
Yeah.
Leaked. It was like they were exposed.
They were hacked.
Yeah, they were hacked.
They were hacked from the cloud. It was
terrible. It was definitely terrible. Speaking of things that's terrible, I wanted to talk about Carol Sanchez. So she's the 16-year-old young woman who staged her kidnapping in the Bronx. Stanley's over there chuckling.
I was coughing.
Is this a Gen Z thing? I mean, what did you guys think about this?
Kids been getting themselves kidnapped for fake for years. Y'all just late to the game. This happened all the time in East New York.
Really,
I'm
Stanley?
Not surprised by this. I mean, I am surprised, and it stinks because there are black girls getting kidnapped and trafficked all over this country, and we're not taking it seriously enough. But when she went missing, and I watched the video, I thought something was off. Then when she returned her toast to the same exact place, I was like, uh-oh, this can't be good.
But you have to ask yourself, what's going on in that girl's home that she would want to stage a kidnapping? You know, it's
deeper.
She has
Caribbean parents and a Crip boyfriend.
It's deeper than just...
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Nah, I agree with you.
I got to disagree here. She has a 23-year-old Crip boyfriend, and her parents were probably like, you're not going to be hanging out with these disrespectful people. You're not going to be hanging out with this guy who's too old for you. We're sending you to Honduras. And she was like, I'm not going to Honduras. So she went to her 23-year-old Crip boyfriend, who she should not be dating because he's 23 years old, and he was like, I got a plan.
Stage a kidnapping? Look, I'll say this about... This was next level. I get it. There are reports saying that her mother was restrictive. Look, I also grew up in a somewhat restrictive household. I would have never thought of this. And she's 16. Look, in another year and a half, you'll be out, you know, going to college and living your own life. You'll basically be an adult. Just come on. Like, just, it's a year and a half more. Or 2 years.
When I was 16, the only thing I was staging was how I was going to sneak out of the house and get back in without getting caught. But I was definitely not staging how am I going to disappear for the next, I don't know, little bit kind of thing.
If I would have staged a kidnap, my dad would have been like, let him go. Less bills for me.
I don't know. I'm kind of with Ilyssa on this one. I just don't know. I can't say exactly what the family dynamic is. We don't know if there's abuse going on. Sending her back to Honduras, you know, America definitely has problems, but Honduras is one of the most violent countries in South America.
That's true.
So I don't know what's back for her in Honduras. I don't know if it's better than what's here. I don't know the whole story. I definitely know this wasn't the way to go about it, no doubt. And this man actually pushed her own mother in order to put her in. So that's
wild.
Well,
they have to make it look real.
Still, that is wild disrespect.
She had a plan out. Look, at 16, she had a little blueprint. She
no, I did not.
But I just want to add, so the side note to this.
Yes, continue.
The side note to this was, and Jumani Williams brought this up, that it took 12 hours for this Amber Alert to be reached. And that is not usually the case. It's usually between a half an hour and an hour.
Right.
So he, of course, brings up, is this because it's a black girl as opposed to another girl that it's actually going to take this long? Because 12 hours is a ridiculous amount of time to release an Amber Alert.
Yep.
I mean, yeah, you can't dismiss the racial dynamic. I 100% agree there that, you know, she's a young black girl, and of course we don't get the same type of attention. But I will say that the fact that so many celebrities and people were reposting and looking for this girl, they were plastering up her poster all over the Bronx. People like Charlamagne Tha God were speaking out, and then to find out it was one big hoax, it just doesn't. We already have it hard as young black girls getting the attention deserved when it comes to situations like this and sex trafficking. But I get it. She's 16, so she can't think that far ahead. But it just makes it worse.
But this
no, it doesn't. No one cares about black girls anyway. Whether she did this or not, that was not going to change anything.
Yeah.
That's just, like, we live in a racist world, and black women are black, and they're also women, which makes the world care about them that much less. They're at the bottom of the totem pole. What this young lady did was dumb, but she's 16, and 16-year-olds are dumb. So
yeah,
I'm not
are,
surprised.
True.
We shouldn't put, I'm not saying that you're doing this, but we shouldn't put any of the fault about the way that we treat black women, or we don't look at their crises on this girl. And we should know that the fact of the matter is, we had to change the way that we value black women and girls in this country, period.
Yeah.
I mean, a few years ago, there was a Muslim girl who faked an attack on a train. Do you remember that? Yeah. So she went to the NYPD. She said she was attacked by a bunch of white people on train. And ultimately, it was staged. And it also had to do with a boyfriend. And it also had to do with restrictive parents. So, I'm not justifying this, but... But first of all, this is going to happen every so often. People of all backgrounds are going to have someone who does this. Like Stanley said, the problem is when suddenly that is extrapolated to entire communities of color, whereas like we had this talk and a related topic with what happened with Darius. It's like the leeway just is not the same.
Yeah.
With a person of color as when it is with a white person.
I will say it's actually in some ways, on to your point, shocking that she was actually not charged with falsely reporting a crime or with some other crime due to the fact that there was resources, serious law enforcement resources and money expended to look for her. And in many of those situations, you often would see a black person being charged with a crime for that. So
I'm glad
I'm glad that they decided ultimately not to charge her. But we have seen that kind of thing before happen. And so that really should be the institutional thing that we're talking about in terms of, not just what your point is, but how black people are treated differently by the criminal justice
Speaking
system.
Of black people, Kim Kardashian is black now. Did you guys know about that?
I just saw that on your page.
Yeah. She did a photo shoot, and apparently she's a brown-skinned woman, and, you know...
So
surprise,
is that even her?
It really is. It has been confirmed that that's her, because I question it as well. So Amanda Seales put out a video just describing every single thought and mood I had when I saw this. I mean, the Kardashians have been...
garbage human beings forever.
Not only have they been... No, absolutely. Not only have they been garbage, but they've been appropriating black women's bodies and commodifying for years on end and profiting and exploiting. And again, this is just an example of that. I'm shocked that no one around her... None. I mean, she has black people in her family. She,
like who?
Her husband?
I mean...
We're not.
Well, you know what? You're right, Selena.
Her husband thinks he's a white man.
You know what's crazy? Kanye might divorce her now because she's a black woman. You know Kanye don't like black women.
Well, no, I don't know about that. But I'm just trying to say no one around her was like, Kim, you trying to look and appear as a black woman is no longer a good idea. Don't put on blackface?
Not no longer. It was never a good idea.
Thank
period.
You,
end of story. No questions asked further.
Man. Yeah.
She doesn't have those type of advisors with her fame. It's just an echo
And
chamber.
Her husband's Uncle Tom, who thinks that white people loving him is how he's arrived at life and is doing well for himself. So, yeah.
Not for nothing. At least Rachel Dolezal was trying to do work for the black community.
Yeah.
After all that you did dragging her, Stanley.
I'll take her.
Rachel,
you're back.
Seriously. Yeah, no, I mean, it's a disgrace, and I'm just, like, over it and sick of it. And speaking of that, and I know we have to go to break, but Camila Cabello. Also, so apparently a few years ago, she had a Tumblr account and she was putting up very racist memes and sentiment using the N-word with the ER, even calling even calling a fellow bandmate
Normani
the N-word
and Obama.
But now she's asking for forgiveness. She said, "I did this when I was 15." Yeah, she was a teenager. Does she deserve to be forgiven?
She wouldn't even say what she did wrong. And, like, one of the reasons she left Fifth Harmony was because she was racist and problematic. No. Why do you deserve forgiveness for something? You wouldn't even acknowledge exactly what you did, and you've had zero accountability.
You know,
I'm tired. All right, let me get out of my bag. Alyssa, hold it down for me.
At 15 years old, you should be dumb enough to stage your own kidnapping and smart enough to know that if you're not black, you shouldn't say the N-word.
Although hello, somebody.
You know that how I feel. I don't think anybody should say it, but that's another conversation for another day.
Yeah, well, look, she's canceled in my book. Actually, I never really liked her anyway.
Same.
So it is what it is. On that, we do have to take a quick break, but don't go anywhere. When we come back, we're doing our own personal 10-year challenge on Let Your Voice Be Heard.
Well, hold on, guys. This is also our intern's last show. And this song right here, dedicated to you, Mariah. And you're too young to appreciate this song. That's why I got it on. I turned it down so we don't lose Facebook Live. I want to celebrate 2019, but that baby is over. Selena's clapping like a church beat because you know she wants some gospel. We are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM WHCR, the voice of Harlem. If you are just tuning in, this is Stanley Fritz. I'm here with Selena Hill, Evan Mastronardi, and of course, the immaculate Ilyssa Fuchs. And before I forget to mention it, our wonderful, our brilliant, our fire Mariah intern is on her last day, and we love her and we're going to miss her. Selena, take it away from me before I start mumbling belligerently.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's the 10-year challenge. And, you know, Stanley, when you were thinking about this segment and you brought it up, you had so many thoughts about the past 10 years. Tell us what you were thinking.
Yeah. So, yes, this was all my idea and only my idea only. I just want to point that out. So we're closing out the year 2019, and it kind of hit me a couple of days ago. We're closing a decade. This has been like a big 10 years, and it's pretty interesting because a lot of the people that I spent a decade with, I'm ending it with. I want to say, like, I've spent most of my decade and even longer than that with Selena, and I'm really happy I'm still here with her now. But it got me reflecting on a lot of things. The person that I was in 2010, freshly graduated from SUNY Northwestbury, 23 years old, not really sure what he wanted to do, a very different political analysis. And where we were as a show, the show didn't exist again yet. We had left it in college, and, like, we kind of both had a vacuum in our lives. And I started thinking about all the people we've had on the show, people who played a big role. Alyssa's been with us for, I think, almost 7 years.
Yep.
And we're all in different parts in our lives now as 2020 comes in. And as Alyssa and both Jackie aren't on the show as much as they used to be anymore, we thought this would be a good opportunity to just kind of reflect as a team about the show, ourselves, and just the world at large.
Yeah.
So, we're really happy to have Evan here to have this conversation with us, and we have a surprise caller for you as well. But this is what it is, the 10-year challenge, Let Your Voice Be Heard. We first started our show here at WHCR in 2012.
Yeah.
I still remember that. It wasn't. Go ahead, Selena.
Yeah, no, it was 2012 and we started here at, WHCR. And I wanted to just kick things off by asking, where was everyone back then in, like, 2010-ish, right, when we first started this decade? Where did you stand politically and how have your political views evolved since then?
Something you're looking me deeply into my eyes. I guess I'll answer the question first. You know where I was in 2010. I was a center-right Democrat. I was a neoliberal who, like, supported Obama and loved Obama, but was really into respectability politics. I thought you shouldn't say the N-word. I thought black people should pull their pants up. And I was trying very hard to build myself up in a way that white people would find me approving. white people would approve
approvable.
Of me.
Yeah, no, is that even
you.
A word?
No, it's, so. It's probably not.
That's right. We're making words up.
And
now.
Then also,
it's 2020.
I wanted to run for office, which is crazy.
Oh yeah,
you remember that, Selena?
I do. Didn't you want to run for mayor at one point?
Not president.
Oh, president? Yes, yeah. You were ambitious.
Yeah, right. No more ambition over here, baby. I was also very religious.
That's not true.
Oh, my God, you were.
Your ambition has just changed.
I know. There we go. Thank you, Ilyssa. I was very religious. I was a Christian. Oh, man, that was a weird time. But, yeah, I was living in South Ozone Park, Queens, with my friend Mikey and Zach. Those are some good times. Selena, how about you?
Yeah, so in 2010, I was way more optimistic about politics and the direction of this country. It was Barack Obama's. He was still in
his second year in office at that point.
Yeah. Yeah, because he was elected 2008, started 2009.
Right.
And actually, in 2010 is the year he got trounced in the midterms.
Yeah, I remember that. But still, it just felt, you know, he was the president of hope, stability, constitutionality. Like, he meant and represented everything that is good about this country. Mm-hmm. And the fact that I was around and could say that I helped elect the first black president into office meant so much to me on an emotional level, like deeper than politics. Mm-hmm. I want to say back in 2010, I was also way more radical. I think that, you know, things kind of shifted for me. Stanley and I had the opposite. He was more center right of a Democrat. Me, I was way more progressive. Like, I'm someone who at this point defends, you know, Jay-Z and the NFL deal. Back then in 2010, remember, this, you know, Occupy Wall Street was still fresh in our mind.
No,
it happened in 2011.
Yeah, and that was part of the things that radicalized me.
Right. So I did want to get there. You're right. It happened in 2011, but this was also still under Barack Obama's first term as president. And, you know, Occupy Wall Street also helped me become more radical when it came to capitalism. It really shed a light and a spotlight on, like, the evils of it and the detriment of it. And that's why I think I was way more left than maybe I am on certain things now.
See, and I think I'm more left now than I was back in 2010. Mm-hmm. But actually, so in 2010, I was in my second year of law school. I wasn't exactly sure what I wanted to do yet or where I was going to end up now. I didn't know any of you yet. In fact, I met Stanley in 2013. I was looking back at my emails. The first show of Let Your Voice Be Heard that I ever did was in June of 2013. But what I remember the most about 2010 was the midterm elections. Barack Obama had won, obviously, in 2008. Democrats were feeling really good. We really thought we were going to be moving the country in the direction that we wanted to be going. And then in 2010, you had the rise of the Tea Party. Mm. And you had all these people come out in the first backlash to the 2008 Obama election. And as I mentioned before, he absolutely got trounced in the midterms. Democrats lost the House. Yep. They lost the Senate. And after that, really, we spent the next, until 2016, when Barack Obama left office, dealing with complete obstruction by the Republican Party. And after the Affordable Care Act was passed, basically Obama was not able to get anything done because of this obstruction. And that all really started in 2010.
Where was everyone else? I want to get to you, Evan, obviously, but I want our listeners, like, call in and leave us comments on Facebook Live about where you were 10 years ago politically, if you even had a political analysis. Go ahead, Evan.
Yes, and I think I was a little bit, like, I wouldn't say I was center-right, but I was definitely more centrist. But it was also due to, like, just me learning about, like, what it meant to be centrist, what it meant to be more radical and more left, because it seemed like kind of the status quo at the time for me to be more centrist. Because the other reason why... is that what was difficult for me that I was able to get by the end of the decade is when I had opinions, I really kept them to myself. When I had political opinions, I felt nobody's going to want to hear it. Who cares? I thought it wasn't going to make an impact. But, like, year after year, I was realizing, well, each of us has a very unique perspective. And there's a loss if you don't share it. Because maybe your perspective is something that, as long as one person didn't hear it and they learned from it, mm-hmm. that it's worth it to share it. So I think that I definitely became more liberal, but it was less because of, like, really instilled values. It's me just thinking about what those positions meant and educating myself, having more personal experiences, and then ultimately deciding that we all have a voice, we all should share our voice, because you never know if your perspective is nuanced enough to, like, you know, affect somebody.
That's a really good comment, Evan. Yeah. Thank you. And, like, it's funny. So we're getting some comments here. I got a comment from Sam Law. She says, I was a Republican 10 years ago, and now I'm a Libertarian. I wish I had more time to find out how she had that transformation, which I don't think is much of a transformation with today's, like, Republican and Libertarian parties. But, like, I want to dig in with that with her one day. So we'll do that one day, Sam. But that's really interesting to know. It's funny because, Selena, you haven't necessarily moved to the right.
No, I didn't say I did.
Yeah. Uh-uh. But, like, you know, like, you're definitely not as, like...
radical. Yeah, yeah, as leftist. Used to be. Yeah, absolutely.
So, I mean, we all have had some kind of change. So what political or social movement within the last decade impacted the way of your thinking? So I'm not going to go to you first, Lena, this time. I'm going to go to Ilyssa first.
I thought long and hard about this question, but the truth is I didn't have to. As soon as I saw this question, I knew right away what really changed, and that was Eric Garner getting killed. I mean, I always knew that I really wanted to do criminal justice work. When I was in my first year of law school, I interned at the public defender's office right here in Harlem, and in my second year of law school, which was 2010, yeah, I interned at the Legal Aid Society. But when Eric Garner died, that's what really, really changed things. I mean, Occupy Wall Street sort of was the beginning of that, and me really reckoning with capitalism and taxation and why there was so many, you know, millionaires and billionaires in the country, and why so many of us had so little and so few people had so much. But when Eric Garner died, that was really the catalyst for me into becoming more radicalized, becoming more involved in going out to street protests, becoming more involved in civil rights work. And that obviously set me on the trajectory for where I am now in my life.
Yeah. And Evan, what about you?
I'd say for me, it was Trayvon Martin. I think that really affected me. I always knew that there were many issues with the police. I wouldn't say I was one of those people who was like, oh, it's just a few bad apples. I realized it was a systemic issue, but part of me always felt like it's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to, like, you know, support the police to some extent. Yeah. And of course, there are some officers that definitely do a great job, like Edwin Raymond, who you've had on this show. But I felt like there were too many people who weren't speaking up about this child who was killed senselessly. And I felt that was when I started saying, I have to find a voice too. You know, I'm just one person, but I want to be one person that, you know, advocates for this man's humanity. And then going forward, I realized that that's a really important thing, value to hold. And I think going forward after that, I realized, yeah, every time someone's humanity is at risk, especially based on things like racism, police brutality, I should say something.
Yeah, Selena?
No, I mean, it's pretty much the same. I mean, it was Occupy Wall Street in 2011. And, you know, Stanley and I were both, Stanley, I know we were part of one of, like, the founding members, but I had a chance to go down there a few different times and protest. But then in 2012, when Trayvon Martin died, that pretty much catapulted or created who I have become today. Yeah. I was following story when it was still a local news story in Florida, and we were doing Let Your Voice Be Heard, and the team didn't want to cover this story.
No, Stanley didn't want to cover the story.
Dustin either. Dustin, well, I mean, the team. You, and because you guys have the loudest voices, you guys were the team. Yeah. And Stanley, so again, back to Stanley's point, you were way more conservative back then, and you didn't really see, I guess, the injustice in this story. Nonetheless, we ended up covering the story, and it exploded into the national discourse and really triggered the Black Lives Matter movement.
So I want to get to a comment. Ilyssa, do you want to read the comment we saw on Facebook Live?
Yeah, so Donnell says social media shifted the narrative from regular corporate news. And I think that's right. Another big thing that I was thinking of in terms of what changed me politically from then to now was in 2010, I had Facebook, but it was before, like, the pages and the groups and all that stuff. Yeah. And in 2012 is when I started my page, Politically Preposterous. And I started that in connection with the fact that I had just graduated law school and I was still looking for a job. I didn't have a lot going on. And I also started that in connection with the fact that Mitt Romney was running against Barack Obama for the election. I really wanted to be involved in some way. And because of Politically Preposterous is how I actually met Stanley. Yeah. And because of meeting Stanley, I met Selena. And that's why I'm here on this show today. So I do think that social media, it wasn't just a shift in the narrative from social media to corporate news, but it also was a shift in the way social media was used to connect with people from when it first really started, and people were using it to connect with their college roommates people, you know, that they were going to school with, to really getting to talk to people about politics across the spectrum and both, you know, throughout the country and the world.
Yeah, that's a really good point, guys. And if you want to call in with a question or a comment, the number is 212-650-6903. Again, that's 212-650-6903. We do have to go on a quick break, but before we do, I just want to share mine. Well, first off, I was not a co-founder of the Occupy Wall Street. I was there pretty early in the process. Thanks, shout out to NYPERG, former executive director Rebecca Weber, who encouraged me to go to Zuccotti Park right before it blew up. But Trayvon Martin really was the thing that changed everything for me. And I want to thank Selena for fighting to get that topic covered. Because at that point, I was still pro-cop and I thought that the system worked fairly. And it didn't. So, guys, this is another 2010s era song. This is Usher, Oh My God.
Maybe I can break you down. There's so many ways to love ya. Got me like, oh my God, I'm so in love. Found you finally. You make me wanna say, oh, 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 my gosh.
Oh my God, we're back real fast, weren't we? We are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM, WHCR, the voice of Harlem. If you are just tuning in, this is Stanley Fritz. I'm here with Ilyssa Fuchs, Selena Hill, Evan Mastronardi, and of course, Spire Mariah, the littest intern of all littest time. And we are having a show where we just reminisce on the last 10 years, the 10-year challenge. We talked about where we were politically in 2010. We talked about the political or social movement that impacted us and shifted our thinking during that time period. Me, Evan and Selena said Trayvon Martin. Alyssa says Eric Garner.
Which was in 2014.
Which was in 2014, yes. That feels like it was just yesterday.
No.
It's so I mean, it was just yesterday that Daniel Pantaleo finally got fired, so.
Yeah, and he's suing to get back.
Yeah, he'll win.
Yeah. So I want to switch this up, and this one is really special to me, this next question. What were your goals in 2010, and did you accomplish them? Selena?
Yeah, so in 2010, I just wanted to be a working paid journalist. I wanted to work at CNN. I would say, yeah, I accomplished that. I became a working journalist. And after I blew my first interview at CNN, I actually, years later, I got called in for another interview and actually got a job as a freelancer, which I turned down. So, not only that, but I wanted to run my own media company. So in, 2010, 10 years ago, I was like 21, 22, definitely as ambitious as Stanley, who wanted to be president. And I definitely wanted to also run a company that would be in competition literally with CNN or MSNBC in the fact that it would offer an alternative perspective for news and commentary that was, more representative of me as a young Black woman. Mm. So those were the goals that I had.
Nice. Alyssa, what about you?
So, yeah, in 2010, I wanted to graduate from law school and pass the bar, which I did. And I wanted to be a successful lawyer, which I have, for the most part, I would say, become. Although the one difference is back then, I really wanted to be a public defender. That did not work out. But as they say, when one door shuts, other doors open. And even though that door shut on me, many other doors open. And I actually have a job now that I really like, doing civil rights work and still doing some criminal defense and getting to hold law enforcement accountable. So it all sort of worked out. What's the phrase for that? The cookie crumbled the way it was supposed to crumble. I don't know.
Nice.
I think I'm mixing metaphors over here.
Evan, what about you?
I definitely wanted to be known for something creative. And I felt like my problem was always like isolating where to start because I have so many interests. But ultimately, I did go with the thing that I was best at doing right now, which is writing. Mm-hmm. And I wanted some of my writing to be known, especially after that shift in my political opinion, mainly to be more active and not just internalize my views. And I feel like to some extent, with Let's Not Be Trash, I mean, we're not exactly rolling in the guap yet. We're not exactly too famous. But we still have something that people appreciate. And we started our own little movement. And I think to some extent, like, that is a goal that I achieved.
Yeah. So we have a special caller on the line. I want to shout out Jackie Coben. Jackie, say hello to the folks on the show.
What's up,
Jackie?
How's it going, guys?
We're doing pretty good so far. How are you, Jackie?
Good. Happy Hanukkah.
Happy Hanukkah.
Happy Hanukkah.
So, Jackie, I want to ask you a question. This is perfect timing, actually. So this is our 10-year challenge, reflecting over the last 10 years. Obviously, you've gone from being, like, a full-time co-host to a correspondent who comes in when she can, like Alyssa. What impact has Let Your Voice Be Heard had on you over the last 10 years?
Oh, my God. I was listening to Let Your Voice Be Heard years before I was even on the show. Stanley, you and I met in 2011, if you can believe that. So we've known each other now for almost a decade. And then I remember early on you telling us about the show when you guys were recording it out on Long Island. So I've been listening to the show for years. I mean, like, you know, I think first and foremost, I have it provided three very, very close lifelong friendships with you, Stan, with Selena, and with Ilyssa, that I'm very grateful for. I mean, when I started coming on the show, I never thought in my life that, like, you know, years from then, the three of you would be making a toast at my wedding. So there, that's first and foremost. But
neither did Selena.
Yeah, right. But I think, you know, even more than that, like, when we started the show, I don't think I realized how important and necessary it was to have the kind of space to just, like, talk, right? To talk as friends, to talk as people that are interested in politics about what's going on and how issues that we're facing each day impact us in our daily lives and in our work. And I think as, you know, now in 2019, I mean, the world is such a different place than it was when I started my time on the show. And I think that it's more valuable than ever to have that kind of discourse and to have the space where people can safely just, like, discuss ideas and thoughts and disagree in a way that's, like, you know, productive and respectful. And I really value the time that I had on the show. And I think that spaces like Let Your Voice Be Heard in providing, you know, room for discourse is really important.
Yeah. No, and you know, Jackie, it's so good to hear from you. Your voice is so reminiscing. Yeah. Thanks for calling in. And it's so funny that you say that, because I remember one of the biggest shows and the most impactful shows that we had was a few days after Charlottesville, after that rally. And I remember you distinctly saying, we are the best show to talk about this, because we all know that the white supremacists were targeting the Jewish community and always, you know, the Black community. And at that time, with us being Black and Jewish voices, and, you know, and also representing queer voices as well, it was like there was a collective and we could speak authentically on how this was impacting us in real time. And we weren't seeing that, frankly, in mainstream media or anywhere else, honestly.
Yeah. Right. I always value the fact that we weren't trying to be pundits. We're never trying to, like, mirror MSNBC or CNN. Like, we keep it real, and we lend our voices to very real problems. And I always really appreciated our callers and the feedback we got on Facebook Live and through social media, because people were able to connect these major news stories to what was happening in their everyday life.
Jackie, thank you so much for calling in. Thank you for all the time and energy you put into the show, and we will talk to you soon.
Likewise. I love and miss you guys, and I'll see you soon.
See you soon.
All right. Bye, Jackie.
Bye, Jackie.
All right. So, Selena, I want to throw this to you as the founder of Let Your Voice Be Heard, who came up with the idea in 2005, 2006, and now we're here in 2019. And you're still going strong, Selena. This is like you built this, and all these people have been impacted by something you came up with when you were a 19-year-old college sophomore. What impact has Let Your Voice Be Heard had on you over the last 10 years?
Well, first of all, thank you, Stanley. But obviously, you know, you, Stanley, as the most instrumental voice in Let Your Voice Be Heard and the longest serving co-host here, you know, you've been extremely impactful. People like Ilyssa, you know, who came in 2013, and really shaped the voice and the brand, and, you know, Jackie as well. I mean, and then also, you know, obviously we still have, you know, Evan and our other correspondents. Like, this is always being a team effort. It's always been collaborative. I've always listened first and try to figure out what it is and what would be best for us. I would say it feels good to know that we're still doing, like, we still have the core mission at hand, which is to inform, educate, and empower, particularly people of color from marginalized communities and whose voices aren't being represented in mainstream media. So it feels good to know that the work is still being done. And yes, we are making an impact. Absolutely.
Now, so Evan, I'm gonna switch a question over for you, and ask you, what are you looking forward to for the next 10 years? But Ilyssa, I want you to answer the previous question when he's done. Okay.
Okay.
All right, go ahead, Evan.
On a personal level, or like in the country?
Both.
Well, on a personal level, like I said, I want to develop any creative endeavor that I've, like, for me, a lot of things I've kept internally because I was like, oh, I gotta focus on stability. I got to focus on, you know, paying the bills, and I got to focus on, you know, being practical. And that's still true, but I hope to get paid for something creative and something I love to do. So that's one thing I want in the next 10 years for myself. Politically, I really hope that, of course, this country shifts more what we call to the political left, what I call just, you know, respecting humanity more, respecting civil rights more, social justice more. And I know the next 10 years won't solve all of that, but I hope people will be, through some way, perspective, more open-minded, and we make significant steps forward in those causes.
And Ilyssa, how has Let Your Voice Be Heard impacted you over the last 10 years?
I mean, this show has had a huge impact on my life. For one, as Jackie said, I've met three lifelong friends. And actually, though, it's more than that. Even though I don't see Jason as often as I used to, you know, I consider Jason to be a lifelong friend of mine as well. Miss you, Jason. And I really felt like it gave not just me, but all of us a platform to be able to speak to people in our age group about really important things that were going on in the world and going on in the country and in the world. I mean, we did shows, especially back when we still had the two-hour slot, where we addressed things that were going on in countries like South Sudan that nobody here in America was really talking about. We talked about what was going on in Yemen. We talked about what was going on in our own country and all over the world, and especially addressing marginalized people both here and abroad. Yeah. And I think that we've really gotten to grow the show. And I can remember back when I first started in 2013, we didn't even have Facebook Live, let alone any real viewership. And then when we finally did have Facebook Live, we would sometimes have two or three people watching our show, and it would usually be like my mom and Jackie's mom. And now, actually, I'm looking at our Facebook Live feed, and there is 20 people watching our show right now. And this show has given me a platform to be able to express things that are politically important to me, and to talk to my, you know, colleagues and people my age. But it has also, as I said, given me lifelong friends, and I am grateful for every minute that I have spent on this show.
So, you know, we do have to wrap this conversation up just real quick. And folks can answer this in like 15-second soundbite, starting with Selena. Mm-hmm. What needs to be done to ensure that the next 10 years are more progressive than the last?
Yeah, so I think that we have to continue to vote. I think that the 2010s proved to be a decade of activism. We saw everything from Me Too to the March for Our Lives to Black Lives Matter to, I mean, every single year we were marching, we were in those streets, and we were making our voices be heard. We have to keep it up because, I mean, it's what a time to be alive. Like, we still have a supreme white supremacist in the office, and if we don't continue to speak up and speak out now, then we see where the direction of this country is going to go. And Stanley, please, when you close out, we have to know what your thoughts about Let Your Voice Be Heard are.
Absolutely. Evan?
I agree with Selena. We definitely have to vote, and I think especially in local elections, that's important, whether it be for more progressive DAs, whether it be more progressive, you know, council people, because there's so much on a local level that can be done for these communities. And yeah, I also hope that we revisit cancel culture, and because what we need to get more progressive is a bigger table and more people at the table. We need to add people to this movement, not keep it in a vacuum.
Yeah.
I agree with that. I would say that we need to see through the promises, or the thing that we were fighting for when Occupy Wall Street started, continue to address income inequality, which has a huge impact on how we operate as a country. We need to honor the legacy of Trayvon Martin and Tamir Rice and Eric Garner and all the people of color that have been killed by the police in the past decade through social justice and continuing that fight. And yes, we need to vote, but people our age need to start taking the mantle and running for office themselves so that we can realize the goals that we started fighting for at the beginning of the decade.
So I'll keep this quick. For the next 10 years, we need to do what Let Your Voice Be Heard has done. What Sean Harris just said to us in the comments is like, just keep going. That's the best thing you can do. Keep going. When Selena called me almost 10 years ago and was like, hey, Stanley, I want to bring back Let Your Voice Be Heard, I had no idea I'd be 33 years old, still doing this strong and still having these conversations. and the show has been a part of my political transformation. It's helped me improve as a person and given me some lifelong friends. And I'm happy and honored and humbled to be in this space to talk to you and be with these people. So what I want to do is I'm going to keep on going, keep on pushing the show, keep on pushing my friends, and keep on pushing the movement. So for the next 10 years, let's change the world by keep on keeping on. And with that, guys, we will see you in 2019.
Happy New Year. 2020.
No, never. Yeah, 2020.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year, guys. Have a good one.